My first talk is going to be on Gandhi. The advertised title is Why Gandhi Matters. The title in my head was 10 Reasons Why Gandhi Matters. But I'm going to add an 11th also when the time comes. So Gandhi died 70 years ago. He died on the 30th of January 1948. He was murdered by a religious fanatic. So it's been 7 decades since he died. It's been 150 years since he was born. That's a long time. So why does he matter? Should he matter? In what particular ways should one remember Gandhi? And in my talk, I'm going to offer 10, and then I'll make it 11, reasons why Gandhi, his life, his examples, and his ideas still resonate in the second decade of the 21st century, 7 decades after his death and a century and a half after his birth. So the first reason that Gandhi matters, absolutely the first, and this is the most important, is that he gave India and the world a means of resisting injustice without using violence. I spent the morning in Boston University in the archives of Dr. Martin Luther King, and I was looking at a collection of papers relating to Dr. King's visit to India in 1959. Well, he was a young man of only 31. He visited India. And a year before, he had already read Gandhi. And a year before his visit to India, he wrote an article in an Indian newspaper explaining what he owed to Gandhi. And there he said, precisely what I have just told you, that the most important lesson Gandhi leaves for us is how to resist injustice without resort to violence. And Dr. King explains it very clearly and lucidly. I mean, Gandhi was a very clear, lucid, and economical writer. He never wasted words. And Dr. King clearly was very much the same. So he says in this article, there is racial segregation in the United States, particularly in the South, but also in the North in the 1950s. One option is to acquiesce in it, to accept it. A second option is to use violence against the oppressor, the white man. And he says, I reject both. Through nonviolent collective civil disobedience, I will shame the oppressor into granting me my rights. And this is what I've learned from Gandhi. So that's the first, lesson of Gandhi, that you oppose injustice without using arms, but nor do you acquiesce in it. You know, actually, there's a fourth option that Dr. King doesn't talk about, which is between acquiescence and nonviolence was the method followed by the Indian nationalists before Gandhi came, which was to write petitions to the British rulers. You know, earnest petitions, seeking, almost pleading with them to leave India. So they didn't want colonial rule, but they weren't willing to challenge it in any kind of mass way. So Gandhi called his technique of non-violent civil disobedience satyagraha, or the truth, the force of truth, satyagraha. Now, it is an interesting connection between Gandhi's ideas at this city, well before Dr. King's papers came here. Of course, Dr. King did a doctorate here too in Boston. Thoreau wrote a tract, a famous tract called Civil Disobedience, in which he advocated individual civil disobedience. So for example, there's a famous episode in Henry David Thoreau's life when America goes to war against Spain. And he thinks that this is an unjust war, so he refuses to pay his taxes. And he's put in prison. And his great friend, his fellow Bostonian writer, Emerson, goes to visit him. And Ralph Waldo Emerson goes to visit Thoreau. And when he goes to jail, he asks his friend, Henry, what are you doing in jail? And Henry answers, Ralph, what are you doing outside jail? Right, because it was an unfair, unjust law, war. Thoreau opposed it, but individually. What Gandhi did was to make civil disobedience a collective or mass protest. Because if just one great individual was to protest, it wouldn't have an impact. You know, Thoreau was not able to stop the war. He was not able to stop American imperialism through his personal act of conscience. But Gandhi developed this technique where he would inspire hundreds and thousands of people to collectively break the law. He first did it in South Africa against racial discrimination. Then he did it in India. For example, the Salt March, where hundreds of thousands of people filled the jails by defying the colonial law, which gave the state a monopoly on the manufacture and sale of salt. You know, there's an interesting footnote to Gandhi's this Gandhi's idea of satyagraha. It was first formulated in a public meeting in South Africa, in Johannesburg, in actually a theater in Johannesburg, which was rented by the Indians because they were protesting against the colonial laws. You know, the colonial laws imposed by the apartheid regime did not allow Indians and colored and African people to own property where the whites lived, to trade. There were restrictions on their traveling between provinces and so on. So Gandhi wanted to organize. So he first tried the method of petitioning and appeals to the overlord. When they were when they went nowhere, he organized this meeting in a theater in Johannesburg. On the 11th of September, 1906, where he decided that they would offer collective civil disobedience. So satyagraha, non-violent mass protest against injustice, was born on a 9/11, 95 years before the more famous or the more notorious 9/11. And if you look at the history of the world, wherever the oppressed have sought emancipation or justice through armed struggle, this has only led to more bloodshed, continuing violence, hate, anger, resentment, and it's not led to any successful resolution. So this is the first reason Gandhi matters, is that he gave India and the world a means of resisting injustice without using force yourself. The only violence you used was against your own body. You fasted, you went to jail, you stayed in harsh conditions, you suffered. You didn't make your oppressor suffer physically. The second reason that Gandhi matters is that he was a patriot, but not a nationalist. So a patriot is someone who loves her country. A nationalist is someone who hates the other guy's country. And Gandhi loved his country and his culture while recognizing its disfiguring qualities and seeking to remedy them. Among his campaigns was a lifelong struggle against the obnoxious practice of untouchability, where a large section of Hindus were literally beyond the pale. And dozens, in fact, several hundred pages of my book are devoted to his campaign against untouchability. His lifelong campaign against untouchability, in which, of course, other people were also active, sometimes more radical than him. The most interesting, in some ways, the most interesting debate he had was with the great radical reformer B.R. Ambedkar, who was born in an untouchable home himself. So Gandhi did not glorify Hindu culture as great. He said, yes, I love my country, I love its people, but it has some deep and ugly aspects to it. One is the oppression of untouchables, the other is the oppression of women. A little known aspect of Gandhi's life is that he did a great deal to bring women into politics. Again, in my book, I describe how in 1925, at his insistence alone, a female poet named Sarojini Naidu was made president of the Indian National Congress. So that was the most important political party at the time. Gandhi was the leader. It had a succession of male presidents, and Gandhi said, it's enough, you know. Half of India is women. We need a woman president. Sarojini Naidu was qualified intellectually, socially, culturally, politically. And he overcame the opposition of the men in the party. Now, 1925. In 1925, you would not have had a city councillor here who was female, let alone the president of the Democratic or Republican Party. Or you could not have had a Labour MP in England who was a female. I mean, suffrage had just been granted to women in England. So he brought women into public life, which in a deeply conservative, hierarchical, patriarchal society was an extremely courageous thing to do. The third reason that Gandhi matters today is that while a practicing and believing Hindu, he refused to define citizenship on the basis of faith. So his struggle his lifelong struggle, the struggle for which he is most famous, was to free India from British rule. Now, technically, he both failed and succeeded in that the British left in 1947, but they left behind not one country but two, India and Pakistan. Pakistan was created on the basis of faith as a Muslim homeland. But Gandhi, in some of his greatest speeches after the creation of India and Pakistan in the last months of 1947, said, whatever the government of Pakistan does to its minorities, which were Hindus and Sikhs, in India, Muslims, Christians, everyone will have equal rights. And though his last fasts were for Hindu-Muslim harmony, and of course, he was killed by a Hindu fanatic who did not want to give equal rights to Muslims. So this is, again, extraordinary in the modern world. He refused to define, though he was a practicing Hindu himself, he refused to say India is a Hindu country. So this is, in a sense, complementary to his struggle against caste discrimination. Caste divided India horizontally. Religion divided India vertically. And he sought to create bridges between these different religious communities. So that's the third reason he matters. The fourth reason Gandhi matters, and this is something maybe difficult for Americans to appreciate, is that while steeped in Gujarati culture, he was not a narrow-minded regionalist. The reason I say it's difficult for Americans to appreciate is that the nationhood in America is based on a single language, English. You know, this was after the first colonization in the 15th and 16th century and the extermination of the Native Americans. America was, North America, the United States, was populated by successive waves of immigrants coming from different parts of the world, speaking different languages, and they were all made to speak English. In India, on the other hand, you had more than a dozen great classical languages. If you look at the Indian rupee note, I don't know how many of you have seen the Indian rupee note, but here it is, you know, 17 languages. 17 languages, indeed 17 different scripts represented on it. And these are great classical languages with phenomenally rich literature, music, art, poetry attached to them. Now, one school of Indian nationalists wanted to emulate the American or the European model, whereby the country would be united on the basis of a single faith and a single language. Gandhi rejected both. He said, yes, Hindi can be a link language. Hindi was a language spoken by a plurality of Indians, not a majority, about 35%. It can be a link language. But each state must be run on the basis of its own language, Tamil, Kannada, Bengali, whatever. And this is quite extraordinary in the context of the parochialism that is so rampant among Indian politicians in his time and our time too. Just as Gandhi had space and love for religions other than his own, he had space and love for languages other than his own. And much of this he derived from his personal experience in South Africa, which is the subject of the prequel to this book, Gandhi Before India. In South Africa, Gandhi shed whatever parochial Gujaratiness he had, because his closest colleagues were Tamils, Bengalis, Punjabis, all speaking their own language. While his satyagraha in South Africa was failing, it was the people who saved it were Gujarati Muslims. They were Gujaratis, but Muslims, not Hindus. The first newspaper he ran in South Africa, which he founded in 1903, it was called Indian Opinion, was printed in four scripts, four languages. I am open to correction, but in my understanding, this was the first multilingual newspaper in the world. It was printed in Hindi, Tamil, Gujarati, and English. And he brought this experience in the diaspora with him back to India. Had he lived, you know, had he been born and lived and worked in Gujarat, and just lived in Gujarat, he may have never shed his parochial prejudices. But he expanded his worldview, his horizon, by living overseas and going back. And when he went back, he absolutely insisted to his colleagues in the freedom movement that Christians and Muslims and Sikhs would have equal rights as Hindus, and that every great linguistic tradition of India would be preserved, nurtured, and enhanced. In some ways, the Republic of India anticipates the European Union by 50 years, right? And actually, it's much more complex, because in Europe, most of the different languages have the same script: French, German, Spanish, You know, Serbian, Croatian all have the same scripts. Yeah, they all have different scripts. And yet, this, because of Gandhi, this linguistic pluralism was nurtured along with religious pluralism. This is, again, a lesson for the world. I mean, I tell some of my American friends, why are you so paranoid if a county in California has majority Spanish speakers? You know, America is not going to go under because of that, right? Just learn from us, you know. It's perfectly possible for people of different religions and different languages to coexist. So the fifth reason that Gandhi matters was that he knew that while he loved his country, he knew it had a great deal to learn from other countries. You know, Gandhi's view was no religion is perfect. All religions are flawed, my own included, Hinduism included. And no country is perfect, my own country, India included. You know, when President Obama, early on, I think in his first term, he said somewhere, other countries think they're exceptional too. And he had to beat a very hasty retreat and apologize for it. Which is a pity, because there's a kind of American belief that only they are unique, only they are exceptional, they are there to save the world. In the 19th century, the British had that same idea, understanding of themselves. In the 18th century, it was the French. In the 22nd century, it may be the Chinese. But Gandhi had no such illusion. He said he appreciated the richness and the heritage of Indian civilization, but knew that in the 20th century, no country could be a frog in the well, which is his phrase. No country can, he said in 1938, it's quoted here, no country can afford to be a frog in the well. It must look in the mirror of other countries and see what they can learn from other countries. And his own influences were as much Western as Indian. He grew up in India. He was a believing Hindu. His first teacher was a remarkable Jain philosopher from whom he learned both nonviolence and religious pluralism. But the idea of simple living comes from Thoreau and Tolstoy and Ruskin. His closest friend was an English Christian priest called Charles Freer Andrews. So this love for his country combined with a capacious understanding of what his country could learn from other countries is the fifth reason I think Gandhi matters today. In a world that is becoming more and more insular, parochial, jingoistic, xenophobic. So I'm not going to pause. I've given you five reasons why Gandhi's legacy matters. And I'm going to pause and explain how, without these five aspects of Gandhi's legacy, I would not be speaking to you today. I, in Bangalore, an Indian citizen, a historian of the Republic, what people like me, every Indian citizen owes to Gandhi, these five aspects of his legacy, I think, are crucial. Because Gandhi eschewed violence in favor of dialogue, we became a multi-party democracy, not a single-party totalitarian state. We did not go the way of China or Vietnam that won their independence through armed struggle, and the victorious party remained in power ever since. Many years ago, I was giving a talk in the University of California at Berkeley with an Indonesian scholar who was sitting with me. This was a remarkable man then in exile from the military dictatorship. His name was George Adi Jondro. Now he's happily been able to go back. And I remember I was making some critical remarks about India, and George turned to me in front of a group of doctoral students and said, Ram, you don't realize how lucky you are. In your country, you have general elections. In my country, we have the election of the generals. Right. Now, I think this aspect of Gandhi's contribution, that nonviolence is about deliberation, dialogue, reciprocity. You know, Gandhi was not a great political theorist who wrote about multi-party democracy. But by privileging violence over nonviolence over violence, courteous debate over abuse and innuendo, he prepared the way for India becoming a multi-party democracy. Because people like him and the great B.R. Ambedkar emphasized gender and caste equality, these principles were endowed in the Indian Constitution. And this is completely counterintuitive. It goes absolutely against the grain of Indian history. Classical India was, in the terms of the French sociologist Louis Dumont, classical Indians were homo hierarchicus. No civilization has so perfected the theory and practice of hierarchy and discrimination as India. And yet our constitution had equal rights for men and women and for low caste and high caste. Because of Gandhi and people like Ambedkar. Because Gandhi emphasized religious and linguistic freedom, India did not go the way of Pakistan and Sri Lanka, which defined citizenship on the basis of a single superior language and a single superior religion. So Pakistan was created to provide a homeland for Muslims. It had two wings, West Pakistan and East Pakistan. The creator of Pakistan, Muhammad Ali Jinnah, in his first visit as Governor General of his free country to East Pakistan, gave a talk in Dhaka and told the Bengalis, all of you have to learn Urdu. But they resisted, they resented, and 20 years later, they created their own state. Sri Lanka, likewise, the dominant Sinhala population of the south, imposed their language on the Tamil minority of the north. Now, I'm not for a moment suggesting that Gandhi alone contributed to a creation of an independent India with a democratic and pluralist template. I'm not for a moment alone that it was his contribution that he created it. He was the sole inventor. But he played an absolutely central role. And without his leadership and his repeated emphasis on nonviolence, democracy, cultural pluralism, religious tolerance, and social equality, all this might never have happened. Now, I'm going to turn to five more reasons, which in some ways, even the first five reasons are relevant, as you would see, to countries other than India. But the second five are, I suppose, truly universal. The sixth reason that Gandhi matters is that he was a precocious environmentalist who anticipated that unbridled growth and unchecked consumerism would bring planetary disaster. And if you think this is just a reckless quote in the air, reckless claim made, an empty claim made on the basis of no evidence, listen to what I'm going to quote to you now. From what Gandhi said 90 years ago. In 1928, writing in his journal, Young India, Gandhi says, and I quote, "God forbid that India should ever take to industrialization after the manner of the West. God forbid that India should ever take to industrialization after the manner of the West. The economic imperialism of a single tiny island kingdom, England, is today, namely 1928, keeping the world in chains. If an entire nation of 300 million, which is what India's population was in 1928, if an entire nation of 300 million took to similar economic exploitation, it would strip the world bare like locusts." Now, India and China may indeed be possibly stripping the world bare like locusts. And he had an intuitive understanding of the global limits to the consumer society. Now, he did not, the crucial words in this phrase I've quoted to you are after the manner of the West. He didn't say, God forbid that India take to industrialization, full stop. Gandhi knew India was a poor, underprivileged society. He knew and understood that its population had to be emancipated from poverty, drudgery, unemployment. It had to be given safe housing, transportation, a dignified education, a dignified livelihood. But he had an intuitive understanding that the energy-intensive, resource-intensive pattern of development followed by the West was enabled only by its access to vast unpopulated continents, which India simply did not have. There are also other aspects of his environmentalism, for example, in his interest in appropriate technologies, in his interest in recycling, in his skepticism about what chemical agriculture did to the soil, and so on and so forth. So he was a precocious environmentalist. The seventh reason that Gandhi matters, it was his ability to grow and evolve as his career progressed. John Maynard Keynes, the great economist, is supposed to have said, someone asked him, have you changed your mind about X, Y, or Z? And he said, he told this critic, when the facts change, I change my mind. How about you, sir? Now, this is an attribution. There is no clear evidence that Keynes actually said this. But a quote actually made by Gandhi is this, in 1934, he said, it's actually an epigraph to my book, he said, "I make no hobgoblin of consistency. If I am true to myself from moment to moment, I do not mind all the inconsistencies that may be flung in my face." Now, he was always open to debate and argument. He replied to almost all the letters he got. There came a time when he got so many, his secretary had to, bring out only the more important and interesting letters. He offered reply to them in the pages of his newspaper. His whole life was one of debate, argument, reflection, self-correction. If you look at his views on caste and gender particularly, it's very, and race too, it's very easy to quote Gandhi out of context. And many ideologues do this to prove that, to so-called prove he was a racist or a casteist or an anti-feminist. He started out like that. I mean, as a young man, he was a racist. He went to South Africa in 1893 as a 24-year-old Indian racist, but he outgrew it. He started out as a casteist, but he outgrew that too. He was an awful husband and bullied his wife terribly. But slowly he recognized, that women could not be subjects and must be given equal rights in a modern democratic India. And his views on caste and gender are an example of how here is a remarkably open man, who's willing to evolve, change, self-correct based on what he sees around him. The eighth reason that Gandhi matters is that he had a rare knack of making leaders out of followers. He identified talent, nurtured and developed it, and then set it free to grow further on its own. He comes back to India in 1915, and he travels around the country. And in those first, his first major struggle against the British is in 1920. By that time, he had around him 24 extraordinary individuals. Sarojini Naidu, I mentioned, right. Jawaharlal Nehru, who was a lawyer, not happy in the courts, joins him. Vallabhbhai Patel, who was a successful lawyer, a fantastic organization man, leaves his law practice and joins him. Chakravarti Rajagopalachari, a brilliant Tamil intellectual, is persuaded to join him. Maulana Azad, a brilliant Muslim intellectual from the East, joins him. Rajendra Prasad, a very pragmatic, focused organization person. And so he has this whole cadre of co-workers who then, with him, shaped the freedom struggle. Many I have not mentioned. The first close friend in India he made, political ally, was someone called J.B. Kriplani, who was with him in Champaran in the first struggle he led. There are many others. So he, in all his travels, he looks for young talent. Man, woman, high caste, low caste, Hindu, Muslim, Parsi, Christian, lawyer, scholar, professor, scientist, economist, doesn't matter. Finds a way of persuading them to join the freedom struggle. Assigns different tasks to them. So one obvious task is building the state units. So people like C.R. Das and Subhash Bose build up the Bengal Congress. Rajendra Prasad builds up the Bihar Congress. Rajaji builds up the Karnataka, the Tamil Nadu Congress, and so on. So his party has very vigorous state units. Other people are involved in constructive work. There was an extraordinary Columbia-educated economist who joins him called Kumarappa, who's in charge of rural development. Somebody else, Zakir Hussain, education, the PhD from Germany, advises him on education, starts a great national university, and so on and so forth. Right. So Kamala Devi Chattopadhyay, who was, in my view, the greatest Indian woman of the last century, who also did played an important role in bringing Gandhi's ideas to the American South in the 1930s, devotes her life to handicrafts and the revival of Indian textiles. And these are all people nurtured by Gandhi. And this is absolutely exceptional. If you compare Gandhi's ability to make leaders out of followers, to identify talent, nurture and develop this talent, and then set it free to grow further, there's absolute contrast between Gandhi on the one hand and the three most influential Indian politicians after his death: Nehru, Indira Gandhi, and Narendra Modi. Not one of them, despite their many other attributes. Nehru had many attributes, so did Indira Gandhi, so did Narendra Modi. All of them concentrated power in themselves. They had no second rung. They saw themselves as absolutely indispensable to the party, the government, the nation. But since I'm speaking in a business school, I think Gandhi's ability to nurture talent and let it grow is also in contrast to certain CEOs who think that they alone matter to the company, right? So that's the eighth reason he matters. You know, he made leaders out of followers. The ninth reason that Gandhi matters, especially as a public figure, is his willingness to see his opponent's point of view. Political opponent's point of view, his willingness to reach out to all those who opposed him politically, start a dialogue, continue the dialogue, persist even when rebuffed, in the desire to seek a middle ground. He had political views of his own, but he had absolute inability to hold grudges. Some of his critics were absolutely abusive and offensive towards him. Ambedkar is one, Jinnah was another. But he recognized that they represented very important constituencies. Ambedkar represented the repressed caste, Jinnah represented the Muslims, so he repeatedly went out of his way to talk to them, to negotiate with them, with every single viceroy. There were seven viceroys who were in, the viceroy was the head of the British Raj, representing the king. Viceroy means deputy to the king. So these British viceroys, there were seven viceroys in his time in India. He reached out to each one of them before starting a movement like the Salt March or the Non-Cooperation Movement, the Quit India Movement. He would talk to him. He would say, look, I don't want to go start a struggle. I don't want my colleagues to go to jail. Let's find a way out. So this, again, is very, very remarkable and unusual. Not even in his own time. Of course, now we've gone to an extreme. I mean, in the world of Modi and Trump and Putin and Erdogan, you know, this kind of colossal certitude of political leaders has reached an altogether new level. Right? They just can't listen, right? They can only speak. But Gandhi was special even in his own time. I compared him to Nehru and Indira Gandhi, for example. He had no personal dislikes or hatreds. He had intellectual and political differences, but these he hoped to resolve. He was always willing to meet opponents halfway, talk to them, listen to their point of view, find a way of working together. The 10th reason that Gandhi matters is the transparency of his political life. Anyone could walk into his ashram, anyone could debate with him. I quote a lovely story in my book about his ashram. His ashram was his rural settlement in central India where he lived. And you know, by this time, the late 1930s, he was the most important man in India, one of the most important men in the world. Now, if you compare his status in India with that of Churchill in England, or de Gaulle in France, or Roosevelt in this country, or Stalin in Russia, the other extreme, right? Now, these other people, you just couldn't go and talk to them. There were so many barriers of security between you and them. Anyone could walk into Gandhi's ashram. One of my favorite stories, which is related to this book, occurs in the memoirs of a great Hindi writer called Bhisham Sani. There are some older Indians in this room, so they'll know these names. Bhisham Sani was then a very young man. He was in his 20s. He was to become one of the greatest modern novelists of post-independent India. He had an elder brother called Balraj Sani, who was to become one of the most famous film actors. And Balraj Sani was devoted to Gandhi, and before he joined the film industry, went and lived in Gandhi's ashram. And his younger brother wanted to also participate in this, right? So he goes, he asks questions. He goes from Lahore, which is in the Punjab, to Wardha, do a railway journey. And in his memoir of his brother, Bhisham Sani, the writer, in his memoir of his brother, Balraj Sani, the actor, talks about going to Gandhi's ashram, and he reaches at night, and he asks his brother, what is it life like here? So the brother says, no, you can't smoke. If you and I want to have a cigarette, we have to climb over the ashram walls, have a cigarette, and come back. Okay, there's some things that are not very nice, because Gandhi's a bit of a puritanical. But I tell you a story about what Gandhi is like. And, like, you have come from Lahore, people have come from South India, Bengal, just to meet him and argue with him. And he says that, this is a story that Balraj Sani tells his brother. He says that, I'll tell you how democratic Gandhi is, how open he is. Every day, Gandhi went for a morning walk. He went from a walk from his ashram to the next village and back. He loved walking. He walked all across London, South Africa, for the Salt March, walking all the time. He would go for a walk. And on that walk, whoever came to the ashram, either people who were disciples or people like Bhisham and Balraj Sahni, who had come from different parts of India, could walk alongside him and ask a question. So just think of the most important political leader of the country. Some young man, unlikely to be a young woman traveling alone in those days, in the 1930s, takes a train, goes for 2 days, squats in the ashram, gets up at 5 a.m., joins Gandhi's party, goes next to him and starts asking him, you know, Gandhi, you wrote this last time, that was very unfair to the Muslims, it was very unfair to the untouchables, whatever, right? And then Gandhi will answer. Now, according to Bhisham Sahni, Gandhi would patiently entertain any question from anyone from any part of India on his morning walk. However, if the questioner, because there were so many waiting to ask questions, if the questioner got too persistent and asked follow-up questions and would not withdraw, he said Gandhi would gesture like this, and according to this version by a Punjabi, but at Gandhi's gesture, a very tall, very dark, and very smelly South Indian member of the ashram would come so close to the questioner that he would recoil from Gandhi and the next questioner would find his place. Okay, now this is a wonderful story, and Bhisham Sahni says, I don't know whether my brother was pulling my leg or that was actually the case. But the fact was that the transparency of his political life. You wrote to him from far away, he would reply. If he felt your letter merited a public reply, he would print your letter in his newspaper and debate on it, deliberate on it. You could even walk into his ashram, that's how he died, because somebody just came and shot him. Now, I've given you 10 reasons why I think Gandhi matters, and I promised you an 11th. And an 11th because in the cricket team, there are 11 players. All right. Now, the 11th reason that Gandhi matters is that he, again, which marks him out from all important and self-important people, whether in politics or the business world or in sports or in literature or whatever, academics, was his wonderful self-deprecatory humor. And the examples of it in my book and littered across his life, which are not in this book. And I'll give you two and then I'll close. One account, one story is told by Sarojini Naidu, the female poet and politician who was very close to Gandhi. Now, she once went to visit Gandhi on a Monday. On Monday, Gandhi did not talk. He kept a voluntary vow of silence one day a week. So on Monday, he did not talk. Now, if you're going to see a friend or a mentor who can't talk, it's a bit of a problem, especially how you begin the conversation. So Gandhi was sitting, probably spinning. Sarojini Naidu goes into the ashram, and all his associates called him Bapu, which is father. And she's thinking, she's a smart person, so she's thinking of something to catch Gandhi's imagination. So she says, Bapu, on my way to the ashram, I saw the ugliest man in the world. And Gandhi gets agitated. He looks around, calls the secretary and says, give me a piece of pen and paper. I mean, just wants it. Piece of pen and paper comes and he writes, and he hands it over to Sarojini Naidu, who reads out what Gandhi has said, you mean the second ugliest man in the world. Now that's one story where he's mocking his atrocious bad looks. The other is even funnier, which is to do with a visit he made to England in 1931 to negotiate on behalf of the Indian nationalists in the so-called Round Table Conference. And there was a reception that the king threw for the visiting delegates. And as is customary in royal households, and particularly in English, a dress attire was specified, in this case, a three-piece suit. Gandhi had come to England in his loincloth and a shawl. And it took several weeks of negotiation for the king to agree to Gandhi to wear his customary attire. So he goes for the banquet, evening banquet, and he comes out into the street from the palace. It is November and cold. Well before climate change, London is very cold in November. And the journalist asked him, you know, did you feel cold? And Gandhi says, the king had enough on for both of us. Thank you very much. So I think we have how much time for questions? About 20 minutes?
We got about 30 minutes.
30 minutes, yeah. So before the questions start, my second talk will be on contemporary India and the politics and society of contemporary India. So keep the questions on that topic for the second talk. So let's keep the focus on Gandhi here. Yeah. Oh, sorry, he'll come here. I think that's.
Good evening. Thank you so much for your talk. My question actually is kind of a bridge between both the two books.
Yeah.
So you talk about Gandhi and his and the fourth reason why he matters because of regional pluralism, right?
Correct.
How far do you think contemporary India has reached and how far away it has
reached? I'll talk about it in a second.
Oh, you call, okay, thank you so much.
Yeah. But I'll just say one thing. You see, I'll tell you something about Gandhi's ideas without reference to contemporary India, because this issue will come up in my second talk too. But you know, Gandhi had a very innovative attitude to religion. For example, he never went to a temple. His Ram was inside his heart. You know, the kingdom of God is within you was a book written by Tolstoy. It's based on a casual phrase in the Bible, but though, of course, Christians don't follow it because they go to church every Sunday. Tolstoy believed the kingdom of God is within you. So did Gandhi. So Ram was inside his heart, nestling next to Allah. The only time he went to a temple in his adult life was in 1930, in the late 1930s, when, it's described in this book, when the great Meenakshi temple in Madurai, one of the most holy Hindu temples, admitted untouchables for the first time. He said, okay, now I'll go, right, to show that you've done something good. So, and he had a very idiosyncratic and, in my view, original attitude to faith. So his belief was, you are born in your faith. You accept it, but you try and redeem it of its flaws. How do you redeem it of its flaws? By interacting with people of other faiths. So there's a famous remark of his where he talks about his closest friend, the English Christian priest C.F. Andrews. He says, my job is not to make Andrews a Hindu. My job is to make him a better Christian. And Andrew's job is not to make me a Christian, it is to make me a better Hindu. And I think in this reciprocal understanding, you could improve your faith. You could rid it of hierarchy, discrimination, violence, bigotry. So, and in my view, Gandhi's approach to faith is compellingly relevant today because it is opposed both to aggressive atheism. Richard Dawkins wouldn't know how to make any sense of Gandhi. Nor would Osama bin Laden Hindu fundamentalists or Christian fundamentalists. And if you want to read more on Gandhi's attitude to faith, there's a great book by a now deceased Australian scholar, J.T.F. Jordan's. It's called Gandhi's Faith, colon, a Homespun Shawl.
Thank you for the great talk. My question is, in those days, Gandhi communicated with more than millions.
Yes.
But his office was very, very simple, with just a table probably, maybe not even that. How was he able to achieve the kind of communication which today is not possible?
So that's a great question. So, first of all, he did indeed communicate, astonishingly, in a time when there was no TV, internet, and so on. He was known across the world. Several sections of my book, Much of It Is About India, several long sections deal with his international influence. So, there's a lot of, for example, how the French, the Africans, the Americans, the Latin Americans are perceiving him. And the most lovely illustration of his global influence, which is also has a is one of my photo captions, is of an ad taken out by a clothing store in Broadway in 1932. And the ad has, it has a photograph of four guys in suits, probably Wall Street bankers, on a railway platform waiting for the next train, reading a newspaper. And it says, the caption says, Gandhi does not need to read on. Because he wears nothing, that's his problem. But those of you who want to be well-dressed, you have to buy our suits for these seven reasons. Now, in 1932, Gandhi had never been to America. He was never to come to America. The well-dressed man in America knew what he was wearing or not wearing, right? And there are other such examples of his influence all over the world. Now, there's something about him that resonated. You know, the simplicity, the decency, the transparency. Even it was communicated through, you know, what he did, through newspapers perhaps, through word of mouth. Now, the other way in which he managed his time, and that's again a very important part of my book, is that he had an extraordinary secretary. So those of you who are Indians here know that in the literature on Gandhi, that is, that Indians are taught, or used to be taught about, so all that might now go, but that's a separate question. Indians used to be taught. Generally, there are a few people who are very important in Gandhi's life. So Jawaharlal Nehru, Vallabhai Patel, and Chakravarti Rajagopalachari, and a few others, Kripalani, maybe, you know, Rajendra Prasad, Sarojini Naidu. But in my book, the great hero apart from Gandhi is his secretary Mahadev Desai, who was Gandhi's head, heart, and hand, and much more. And he was such an extraordinary, self-effacing person that he wrote himself out of the narrative. But Gandhi could not have functioned without him. So Mahadev Desai was a scholar of English and Gujarati literature with a capacious international outlook. He could argue back with Gandhi. He could translate Gandhi. He could interpret Gandhi. Unlike Jawaharlal Nehru, he was steeped in Gujarati culture and language, so that moral, cultural, ethical world of he could inhabit, unlike Nehru. Unlike Vallabhai Patel, who was Gujarati, Mahadev Desai was international, cosmopolitan. So he was a bridge between the different, you know, parts of India. So if there was a dispute in the Bengal Congress, Mahadev would go to solve it. If the depression happened in this country in 1932 and 29, and Gandhi had to be told what his implications were for Indian textiles, Mahadev would explain to him. So, you know, and he died in 1942 in the prison, which is why Indians have forgotten him. But, you know, he allowed Gandhi to do so many more things. And he translated his works. He translated his autobiography, which was published all across the world, you know, in clear, eloquent prose. He would write these daily, weekly reports on Gandhi's activities in Harijan. He saved him from intruders. You know, he even cooked wonderful khichdi, which Gandhi thanks him for. So, I mean, he is in many ways the great hero of this book, because he enabled Gandhi. Gandhi once writes to him, and I quote it again in the book, when he's sick. He says, "You've fallen sick, you're working too hard, take a break." And then he says, "Do you realize that if you were to fall sick, I would have to wind up 3/4 of my activities?" So that is Gandhi's tribute to him, right? Now, so he was a one-person secretariat. And I think what Gandhi did, and what his outreach to different parts of India and the world, Mahadev was indispensable to all of this.
Thank you. Very mesmerizing talk. If you could take a minute to reflect on the relationship of Mahatmaji with Nehru and Vallabhai Patel, and how it evolved and how it led to what it became.
So,
thank you.
Yeah, thank you. So, as I said, these people all joined Gandhi very early. So, Patel was playing bridge. Patel was a successful lawyer who made a lot of money in the card table. And he was playing bridge in Ahmedabad when news came that Gandhi in distant Champaran in Bihar had been arrested. And he was very impressed that a successful lawyer had defied the British and had been arrested. And he soon joined Gandhi. Patel's great contribution was organizational, building up the Congress Party. Sort of nuts and bolt organization. He was also absolutely devoted to Gandhi. He played an important part in many of the popular movements, particularly the Salt March, the Bardoli Satyagraha, and the Quit India movement. Nehru joins Gandhi. Nehru's father, Motilal Nehru, who was a well-known constitutionalist, Gandhi knew and admired. In fact, Motilal had supported Gandhi's work in South Africa and sent money there, which is there in the first volume. Gandhi comes back, stays with them, and Jawaharlal Nehru is at that stage a dissatisfied lawyer with not much to do, and Gandhi becomes his lodestar. And he pushes his father towards taking a more radical position, from moving from moderate constitutionalism to actually courting arrest. And of course, Nehru is not Gujarati, but there is something that Gandhi sees in Nehru. And quite early, in the late 30s, he anoints him his successor and repeatedly says he will be my successor. He says Nehru will be my successor. Other places he says Nehru and Patel will be my successor in that order. And the most persuasive explanation of why he chose Nehru is provided in an essay by Rajmohan Gandhi called Sons and Heirs, which is in his book, The Good Boatman. And I find it absolutely persuasive. And the explanation is this, that firstly, Nehru, the only two alternatives would have been Raja Gopalachari and Patel. Nehru is much younger. So he's out likely to live much longer in independent India. But that's not the most important reason. The most important reason is that after Gandhi, Nehru was the least parochial Indian. Patel was a Gujarati Hindu and identified as such. Rajagopalachari was a Tamil upper caste Brahmin and identified as such. Gandhi saw that Nehru was a Hindu who was trusted by Muslims, a North Indian who was respected in South India, and a man who believed totally in gender equality, which the others didn't around Gandhi. They were absolute patriarchs. So I think these are the reasons that he saw. And of course, there was a kind of he had affection for Nehru, as you know, they got along well and all of that. But is this, he saw the country as diverse and divided. He was the unifying figure, and only Nehru could be a similarly unifying figure. And I think he was absolutely right in that. Not at all, but you can talk about that. Not at all. What was the mistake was, that Nehru stayed on too long. I'm a South Indian. I can tell you, you ask Muslims, you ask women, right? Anyone who was not a Hindu, North Indian Hindu upper caste patriarch would see what Nehru did for this country. He solidified democracy, he brought us respect in the world. He made mistakes, of course, with economic policy. He stayed on too long. But only he could have kept this country emotionally together after Gandhi. Of course, Patel helped me enormously. And it's very unfortunate that they're seen as rivals today, right? But actually, they were co-workers. Again, in this book and in India After Gandhi, I talk about it. So they had different roles. So they did it differently. Yeah.
I want to comment on the interaction between Ambedkar and Gandhi, especially because Ambedkar was U.S. educated. And did he, my specific question is, did he equate casteism with racism, and did Gandhi support something like that? And what was Gandhi's final view on the annihilation of caste, which...
So that's a very good question. It requires a slightly long answer. So my book has a very detailed first account based on primary materials on their relationship. From the first time they met in 1931 till Gandhi's death. So there must be, out of the 1,000 pages, 150, 180 pages on that. So do read it. It also has a great deal of independent material on Gandhi's old evolving view of caste. Now, Gandhi's views evolve. And they evolve before he meets Ambedkar because of his encounters with other radical reformers. So in my book, so when Gandhi, in South Africa, when Gandhi was 2 decades in South Africa, in the diaspora, caste discrimination is much less. It's there, but it's less. It's there in this country, by the way. I mean, there are Dalits who feel discriminated. But it's relatively less. So he understood the problem of Hindu-Muslim harmony. But if you read his book, Hind Swaraj, written in 1909, it has nothing on caste. It talks a lot about nonviolence, a lot about Hindu-Muslim harmony, a lot about economic self-reliance, but nothing about caste, which was the fourth pillar of his thinking in India. And it's very interesting to trace it as a historian. So in 1915, he comes back. He receives a long letter from a South African associate of his called Lazarus, who was a Tamil Dalit convert to Christianity, who had grown up in South India. And in parts of Tamil Nadu, caste discrimination was absolutely at its most obnoxious, right? So Lazarus writes to Gandhi saying, you've gone back to India, you want to read the freedom movement, don't forget discrimination against untouchables. Because if freedom comes without you attending to it, it'll be Brahmin Raj over the rest of us. And that's the first thing that opens Gandhi's mind. And then he gets an untouchable family into his ashram and he starts thinking about this. And he says then he makes up his mind that untouchability must go. So from 1915-16, he repeatedly gives speeches saying that discrimination against untouchables is bad. But he still has some kind of theoretical allegiance to separation by of castes, at least when it comes to intermixing and intermarriage. The second radical reformer who influences him is the great Malayali reformer Narayana Guru, who persuades him to take up temple entry. So Gandhi says untouchability is bad, but when Narayana Guru says, let's all go to the temples, let's show equality before God, Gandhi hesitates but then joins. Then from there, interdining, and then also he then advocates intermarriage. Once you advocate intermarriage, there is no caste system. So those who claim Gandhi was a defender of the caste system are quoting him from 1915, not from the 1930s. But there yet remains one, so he does believe in that sense, though he doesn't use the term annihilation of caste, he believes in the absolute obliteration of caste distinctions. That all Hindus can intermix, intermarry, interdine, they must have freed equality before God, in the law, all of that, right? But there is still a difference between him and Ambedkar, which is very important and is unresolved till today. Ambedkar came around to the belief that for full emancipation, the untouchables had to leave the Hindu fold. Gandhi felt that Hinduism could redeem, reform, purify itself by getting rid of untouchability. Whereas Ambedkar finally thought there is no hope for untouchables within the Hindu fold. So of course, late in life, he becomes a Buddhist. So there is, at that level there, they cannot be reconciled.
According to you, what could have made the partition less painful? And what was Gandhi's role in the whole process?
That would take a very long answer. But first of all, partition could not have been avoided. Again, this is a lot of misinformation and fake news that is thrown around, including on Nehru and Patel. This is another sub. Partition could not have been avoided. In 1946, there were elections in which the Muslim League overwhelmingly swept the Muslim seats all over India. By this time, Jinnah was not the leader, he was being led. Muslim intellectuals and a large section of the Muslim middle class in northern and western India was captivated with the idea of an independent country. Right. The only way partition could have been avoided, I don't know whether you've studied these documents, was under the so-called cabinet mission plan. Under the cabinet mission plan, the states were they could have seceded. And the princes were also semi-independent, so we could not have been united. Right. Partition, when did partition become unavoidable is also a long and complicated question. Was it 1946 when Muslims all over India voted for us, Pakistan, admittedly under limited franchise, but they did vote? Was it the Quit India movement? Was it 1909 when communal electorates were created? But there was a time, at least by the early 40s, and definitely by 46, when partition could not have been avoided. That's the first thing, the first answer I give you. The second thing is, yes, it could have been made less painful and less blood could have been shed. And for that, the blame squarely accrues on the British. In India after Gandhi, which is a different book from these two, I've described this, that Mountbatten hurried it in haste. He was ill-advised. It could have been done over a period of time. He was told that in the Punjab, the violence would be bloodiest. So army detachments must be moved there quickly. But the British were paranoid that they would be killed. So army detachments were sent to protect British planters in Assam, and no one was going to hit, they were going, right? So it could have been, and not enough care was taken in having administrative structures in place, so that Pakistan had its own police, its own civil service, its own railways, India, to handle all of that. So certainly it could have been made less bloody. The third thing, and this is the most important and most relevant to my book, whatever Gandhi did or did not do to stop partition, once partition happened, no one did more to mitigate suffering. No one did more to mitigate suffering. So on the one side in India, groups like the RSS were fomenting more violence against Muslims. In Pakistan, Jinnah was in his governor general's mansion and not meeting anyone. It was only Gandhi and to a limited extent Nehru who were on the streets trying to bring about social peace. And if he had not, I have a chapter here called The Greatest Fast. Gandhi went on some 24 fasts in his life. The last two were the greatest, in Calcutta in September 1947 and in Delhi in January 1948, where this old man, by the force of example, stopped Hindus killing Muslims and vice versa. So once partition happened, no one did more to try and stop the suffering. And if he had not been killed in Delhi, he was going to go to Pakistan to reassure the Hindu and Sikh minority there. So those are the facts of partition. Yes, go ahead.
Thank you very much for the very insightful, informative talk. I was wondering if you may be able to speak a little bit about Gandhi, this man that was so much ahead of his time and clearly was introducing ideas that were different and potentially controversial to some of the people surrounding him. How did he go about convincing his followers and beyond that of, you know, the validity of these new ideas?
So I think that's a great question. I'd say there were four ideas of his that were absolutely revolutionary and far ahead of their time, to use your phrase. The first was that nonviolence is a better way of settling, of overcoming injustice. Because there was a glorification of violence. The Russian Revolution had happened. People thought that Lenin and company were bringing, you know, utopia. You know, anarchists were killing people all across Europe. There was a revolution in ongoing in China. So it was deeply unfashionable among young men who were in the 1920s. The vanguard of political movements were young men. And there were many young men in India who wanted to shoot the British out of India, scare them, right? So that was one way in which he was absolutely, to use your term, ahead of the curve. The second was, in a conservative hierarchical society, to say women and men are equal and low caste and high caste are equal. And the third was, in a very religiously driven and divided society, to say Hindus and Muslims will live in peace. And the fourth was to say, when there's a manic rush to imitate Western models of development, that hold on, take it easy, think before you leap, right? Now, in the last, he was the least successful, because that was a more intellectual conception of what India should do after independence. He was most successful in persuading the Indian freedom movement to adopt non-violence over violence, and in shaming upper caste Hindus to get rid of prejudice. And Hindu-Muslim harmony was kind of ambivalent because there was loss of life and blood, right? Now, he did it largely through persuasion and force of example. You know, he admitted untouchables into his ashram. He didn't tell someone else to do it. He went and courted arrest and took beatings. He didn't tell someone else to do it. He went on a fast to bring about Hindu-Muslim harmony. So I think the force of example, that here was a person who was willing to live out his ideas at enormous cost to his family life. I mean, among the costs was, I show that he was an indifferent husband and could be an awful father, you know, because his children paid a high cost for that commitment. But I think here was someone who was willing to, as the cliche now goes, walk the talk. But he also had this ability to get this, what I've already talked about, to nurture talent. So, you know, he inspired Nehru. In turn, Nehru inspired many more people. He inspired a Tamil speaker who then took the lesson in Tamil, of nonviolence or of Hindu-Muslim harmony, and so on and so forth. So he was an inspirational, charismatic, courageous figure, but he was also an institutional builder. And he knew he required time, you know, so that's why he had a long life. He did this over a period of 30 years with some ups and downs. But on these four issues, he was unswerving. I mean, I've not quoted in my talk, but there is a lovely remark of his in 1920, which says, when freedom comes, when Swaraj comes, Swaraj will be a bed resting on four posts, nonviolence, four sturdy posts, nonviolence, Hindu-Muslim harmony, abolition of untouchability, and economic self-reliance. Those were his four campaigns, you know, and they were all, in some ways, counterintuitive against the conventional wisdom. It's quite extraordinary how much success he achieved. I mean, his success was not total, but I think courage, transparency, commitment, and the ability to build a team of second and third rung people to take his ideas forward. I mean, he didn't think he could do it all alone. Yeah. Who's next?
Thank you, sir. That was a very great talk. And I had a question that you went over how Gandhi successfully outgrew racism and casteism. His ideas evolved, and he's also often misquoted. So I just wanted to know that, do you think there are any other reasons why Gandhi is often misinterpreted today?
Well, so misquote, see, careless or tendentious misquoting is one thing. But he did have profoundly radical ideas that don't appeal to people. People want to build politics on the basis of religion. Young men, even in India today, want quick change. They think violence, you know, Gandhi's nonviolence is pussy-footed, effeminate, you know, weak-kneed. So the ideas he battled against continue to be influential in many, many parts of the world today, in many parts of India today. So obviously, you know, he's still a figure alive of contention and debate and argument, because, you know, the arguments that he began are still continuing.
So, wonderful talk, and certainly the examples that you have quoted are all just phenomenal. I just have one question which is more to do with, and it might lead to your second talk, but you said Gandhi, for instance, said Nehru would be my successor. So one of the themes that you start to hear from that is that he is passing on baton to another individual, as opposed to what you have argued successfully and rightly,
yes.
The broader democratic thing.
Correct.
And that fault line,
talking
to your next talk, leads to us, I'm talking about us here, India, that the leadership has tended to be, you know, there was a wonderful book written after Nehru, Who, etc., because of the fact that there has been just one leader at any given time who will be the strong one.
Yeah.
And that is a contradiction to what Gandhi wanted, to what India sort of interpreted. Meaning we want one person to lead.
Yeah, so I'll talk a little bit about... In my second talk, I'll talk a little bit about this concentration of power in an individual.
Right.
But in this case, I think it's important to recognize that by the late 1930s, Nehru was the most popular leader in India. You know, there's a famous story of Patel and Nehru going to give a talk and a massive crowd. And Patel says they've come for Jawaharlal, not for me. You know, because he reached out to the Muslims, to the women, to the young. He had interest. So apart from being Gandhi's favorite, he was also the public favorite. I mean, he won 3 elections on his own. Right. So, he stayed on too long. That's a separate question. We can discuss this. But, and I think Gandhi also cared for institutions. You know, it is true that of course, a country is not a corporation. But in some cases, there are 2 cases I can give you from recent Indian history where charismatic founders have chosen able successors. One was Narayan Murthy choosing Nandan Nilekani in Infosys, among 6 others. Right. The other was Varghese Kurian choosing Amrita Patel as his successor. And I think no one could argue with those. I mean, there were options, right? But Varghese Kurian gave his whole life to Amul. He thought, you know, who will come after me? You know, Narayan Murthy said, I'm 70, or he was 60 plus. There were 7 founders, right? So sometimes, I think Gandhi felt that way with the Congress Party. That's one reason, one of the slightly unsavory chapters in his life for which Bengalis have never forgiven him is how he got rid of Bose. Now, he got rid of Bose for 2 reasons. One was Bose did not have a doctrinal commitment to nonviolence. Okay. And Bose actually, there were even some fascist elements in his thought. If you read his book, Indian Struggle, published in 1935, you'll see this. But the other reason was he had built the Congress Party, and Bose had already had 1 term, and he thought that here is an organization he's built for 20 years, which is all in, it'll be captured by someone and taken in a certain way. Right. You know, many Republicans feel that way about Trump today, right? He's come from outside and he's taking the party they built in a certain way. So, you know, but he did it, again, through non-violent means. I mean, he didn't know what Stalin did, which is to kill everyone else, right? Okay, he persuaded the Congress to get rid of Bose. He persuaded the Congress to have Nehru rather than Patel to succeed him, for example, right? So, I mean, in that sense, he was a pragmatic person. He wanted, you know, a certain kind of succession, and he was not above a certain kind of intrigue and manipulation. But, you know, that's, I think, because he cared about the Congress Party. And as these examples of Infosys and, you know, Amul show that if you're so identified, if you built up an organization from scratch and you know you're not immortal, you would want someone whom you think represents that organization's best values to take it forward.
Yeah. Okay, I think we have time for one last question. Ibrahim?
Okay. Good evening, and thank you for the wonderful lecture. I wanted to ask you about how justified would you say was Gandhi's fast that led to Pune Pact? And subsequently, did it hurt or favor his movement against untouchability and the rift between him and Ambedkar that ensued? Yeah.
So, again, that's described at great length in the book, so the whole chapter on that fast and the consequence. So it's clear that that fast had a coercive element to it, right? So it's clear, and I say clearly, that Ambedkar felt coerced, that here was the greatest man in India. If he died, Ambedkar would be blamed for it, right? However, as a result of that, as a result of the fast, two things happened. One is that, of course, the seats reserved for untouchables became much more, and it also shamed upper caste Hindus into opening temples. Right. Now, the long-term question, which is unresolved, is Ambedkar accepted the fast, in which there were no separate electorates, but there was a joint electorate with reservation of seats for untouchables, ex-untouchables. And later on, he felt that separate electorates would be better because you elect your own leaders. Now, that debate is unresolved. There's a good recent book by a Norwegian scholar on whether, what are the contemporary implications of this, you know. Would Dalits have been better off with separate electorates? Yes, they may have elected their own leaders, but they had been cut off from voting in the rest of the population, right? So, I am agnostic about it. I mean, my personal inclination is that separate electorates are not a good idea anyway. But it is true that his fast was felt as coercive by Ambedkar, and that's described in this book. I mean, if you read this book, as I hope you do, one of the things that has pleased me about the reviews is that I tried very hard. You see, the job of a historian is not to be a partisan, right? One of the things that pleased me most about writing India After Gandhi, it's a history of India after independence, what that pleased me most was when I wrote about the Kashmir dispute without being an Indian, being a historian, or about the China dispute, right? So I think I've tried to do justice to both. They were both extraordinary people, and I'm happy that at least some reviewers have seen this, you know, that they were both extraordinary people caught in this combat. I mean, here is an guilt-ridden upper caste reformer battling with the emancipator of his own people, you know, and one is 25 years older. So there is a kind of extraordinary drama to it, right? And the tendency of some people to oppose Gandhi to Ambedkar, I think today India needs both. I mean, we need reform above and from below, you know. And I think in that sense that their extraordinary struggle, I think, has enriched India. Both of them have enriched India. Yeah. Have saved us from some of our most ugly manifestations of our culture and our religion. Yeah.
Ram, I think we've reached the end of our first part. Please join me in giving a round of applause. Thank you. Thank you.